everyone and see some faces that we haven't saw in a while. Glad you came out tonight. Just a few announcements before we get started. You may notice we've got a finance meeting coming up. I think that's Tuesday. So those of you on the finance committee, if you want to come, I think, are we still going to meet, John? Or
yes, we'll meet here.
Okay, we'll meet here in the sanctuary. There's plenty of space in here where we can distance out a little bit. The other thing I want to make, a couple of other things I want to make mention of, we have a homeschooling group that's meeting here on Tuesdays. Wonderful group, and they've got a few kids that come, and they meet up on the third floor of the educational building. They're going to have an open house here, and if you're interested, if you've got some kids or grandkids that are, with all the stuff going on this past year, some people may be thinking about some homeschooling. They're going to be answering questions on the 9th at 1 o'clock up here in the church, and then on the 23rd they'll have an open house where you can come in and actually see how they get together and meet and all, what all they go through through the day. And then our discipleship class, the ladies are meeting on Sunday night. I think they started this past weekend, and there's what, four more?
Yeah, it's a 5-week study.
Okay, there's four more classes to that, so if any of you are interested in that, they're going through Breathe, which is a Priscilla Schreier study.
You messed that whole thing up. Priscilla Shires.
Oh, well, I'm sorry.
Just saying.
Shires.
It's so important to know this.
Okay. So if you're interested in getting her name correct and learning a little bit more about God's Word, the ladies meet in here on Sunday nights, I believe at 5:30. So that's a study that's going to last for the month of February, and then we'll be probably starting something else. So before we get started, let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Father, we do thank you for this time that we have together. Father, to come into your house, and Father, to lift you up in prayer and in praise, and Father, in word. Father, we pray that you'll forgive us where we've fallen short before you this week. Father, we ask for your mercy upon us, Father. We are a nation in distress. Father, we have friends that are in distress, and I do want to especially lift up our brother Terry Stinson, and Father, thank you for the good news that we got today about him. We continue to be with his body and strengthen him each and every day. Lord, just be with our community. Father, we pray that we can reach out to the lost, and Father, just share this good news with them. Father, help us to be bold in our faith as you did so long ago. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the saints, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come to his presence with singing. You want to read along with me? Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you, you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, for sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. Since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. Owe no one anything except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you should not commit adultery, you should not murder, you should not steal, you should not covet, and the other commandments are summed up in this word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Thank you.
scriptures, Christianity is the religion of the heart, of the inner man or the woman, before it is anything else. We've just said that we will sing of our Redeemer, and according to Ephesians 5:19, we are to sing and make melody to the Lord with our hearts. Our salvation comes to us. We are justified in the sight of God when, according to Romans 10:9-10, we believe in our hearts that God raised Jesus from the dead. When we believe that and confess Jesus as our Lord, Christ dwells in our hearts through faith, and the love of God is poured out into our hearts through the working of the Holy Spirit. As Ephesians 3:16 and 17 teaches us, and beyond that, God the Father looks at our hearts and responds to us positively or negatively, depending upon the condition of our hearts. Just as Jesus taught in Matthew 5:8, when he said, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." So as we prepare to look at a passage in Scripture which has much to say to us about our hearts, let's use the next two Psalms to pray with King David, the psalmist who said, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts from which those words come, according to Jesus, be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer, as we prayerfully sing, "Lord, I want to be a Christian."
Lord, I want to be a Christian. In my heart,
Lord, I want to be a Christian. In my heart,
Lord, I want to be a Christian.
to give a big thanks to Judith and Paul for continuing to come and play for us, even though he's on the mend with his voice. And prayers go out to him for recovery through all this. If you got your Bibles with you and want to open up to Ephesians chapter 6, we're going to continue our study there, talking about Jesus over everything. Ephesians chapter 6, and once you get there, I'm going to ask if you'll please stand. We're going to read verses 5 through 9 tonight. Ephesians chapter 6, starting in verse 5. Paul continues his letter to the Ephesian church, saying, "Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear, and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but like slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly, as if you were serving the Lord and not men, because you know that the Lord will reward everyone for whatever good he does, whether he is slave or free. And masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no favoritism with him." Let's pray. Father, once again, as we gather before you and get into your word, Father, we just thank you for your mercy and your grace, Father. Just the simple fact that you saved us. Father, you give us the opportunity now to be part of this master plan that you have to take the gospel into the world. Father, continue to forgive us. Continue to help us to be bold in our faith. And Lord, we just ask for your grace and your mercy. Father, we love you and we adore you. We want to praise you tonight by getting into your word, Father, and helping it to become part of us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, we're continuing in our study through the book of Ephesians. And if you'll remember, Paul is writing to the church. This is a church that is made up of many different people with all sorts of backgrounds. Every single one of them has the exact same Lord and Savior. You see, Christ defines who they are as he defines who we are. He defines us, beloved, as children of the living God, adopted and loved, called to a higher purpose in him. If you have been bought by the blood of Jesus at the cross of Calvary, then you are, in fact, a bond servant of the Lord. See, we have a master. He is in heaven. We all have someone that is over us. And we all should declare, as Joshua did, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." That is our choice in the matter. Now, a bond servant is someone who owes a debt to another. In some cases, it could be paid back or maybe worked off. But in most cases, as in Paul's time, it could not be. It was an indebtedness for life, as is our service to the Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, you think about it. He saved us from a life of sin and death. And there is no way we can ever return that to him. Now, in Paul's day, the empire had grown so much so that there was a laziness that had fallen upon the citizens of Rome. The upper class folks in Rome there, they thought to work was really beneath them, and they conquered so many nations, brought in so many people to their culture that they didn't have to work. And so they got everybody else to work for them. It was slave labor. So you had doctors and lawyers and teachers and advisors and philosophers and bankers and soldiers, personal attendants, all who possibly could be slaves, the educated and the uneducated. It didn't matter. Whatever the case. And we see that throughout Scripture in other places as well. We see Daniel was a slave to the Babylonian Empire, and Joseph was a slave to the Egyptian Empire. And beloved, we didn't see, as we do in our day, these inalienable rights that we talk about in our Constitution. To them, a person was just a thing or another animal or a tool that was at the convenience of others. So it was power and money that dictated your position in the empire. But then came the gospel. This message of salvation, this freedom in Christ. You see, the gospel is not primarily a physical freedom as much as it is a spiritual transformation into Christ-likeness. The gospel focuses first on the heart, as we just sung about. And it brings fellowship with God. It brings freedom from our sin. And then as it changes hearts, it brings the advancement of the kingdom to God. You see, Paul operated on this deep conviction that social and personal conditions were not the primary issue in life. The first order of things was our spiritual condition. Everything else then flows out of that understanding as hearts and minds are changed and renewed by the Word. You know, we think about this passage and we look, how in the world can Paul talk about slavery and masters? And here's a social order that we find very intolerable today. And it's going to be actually hard for us to identify with these folks because we're not slaves anymore in a sense that we have a physical master that is ruling over us. Oh, we may suffer some things. We may go through some hard times and see things that we don't like, but not to the extent that they did. But maybe here's a comparison that we can kind of get underneath. We have a mortgage and we have a 40-hour work week and we have someone that we generally answer to no matter what position you're in. And we may not fear the punishment of death, but there is loss that comes in our situation. And so maybe what we could do is take the principle of what God is trying to apply here and say that God is trying to teach us that all life, no matter where it is redeemable. That everything counts in what we do. Your story, as we've talked about, is God is writing it out. It has a purpose to it. Your relationship as husbands and wives, as we looked at a little bit earlier, they count. How you live singly counts in God's economy. How you interact with the rest of the world, how you raise your children, all of this counts, beloved. We're different than the rest of the world. We've been called, we've been set apart, we've been made as a new creation, and as such, our life's going to look different, and our calling is going to look different than the rest of the world. How we live is going to matter. So the basic disposition of any believer is different than that of the unbeliever. Whereas they serve man and to gain something in this life, we serve Jesus as our master. Even if we're under oppression. So how do we go about, how do we take this and move the message that Paul is trying to get across for us from the home out then into the world with our thinking and our speaking and just doing life? Well, verse 5 says, you were to be obedient to those who are over you in the flesh with respect and fear and sincerity of the heart as to Christ. The word that Paul uses here for fear is phobia, and it can mean anything from a loving reverence to shock and terror. So to get our context, think about how Paul has used this word in previous passages that we've looked at. For instance, verse 21 out of chapter 5 that we've kind of kept as our main theme through all of this, we're to submit ourselves to one another out of reverence for Christ. The fear that is in that part of the passage is described as honor. Or in verse 33 where he says that wives are to respect her husband. That is a fear. Again, the idea there is to give him honor, but it's honor that is motivated out of a devotion to Christ. Philippians chapter 2 verse 12, we're to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Well, that's not terror that we're turning toward God. It's a devotion that we love God and we want to do the right thing for God. Right, 2 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 15, the church is told to receive Titus with fear and trembling. Here's Titus, this young man in the faith that Paul has sent to represent him to teach them his word. And they weren't afraid of Titus. They were to honor and encourage him. And he was encouraged for that. And so all of these examples, it describes for us a loyalty or an attitude whose main concern lies with the thought that we don't want to let somebody down. We want to do the right thing. We want to honor God. We want to serve Jesus in the right way because we understand that there is a greater good in these details. Paul is calling us to this godly disposition here. And he goes even further than that to say that do it with sincerity of heart. So let me ask you this. When you go to work and you look at your boss or you look at the people that are underneath of you, do you think of them as someone that can be redeemed for the kingdom of God? So
See, that's what Paul is calling us to. As you work, you're working first for Christ. You're there to serve the Lord, and then possibly in the process of serving Jesus Christ, you're converting those around you to the faith through your obedience to Him. You see, the motive here is heaven. Our obedience is to be as to Christ. And so the slave was to look upon his obedience as a Christian duty, a service that was performed as though it was done for God Himself. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58, Paul says, "Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm and let nothing move you. And always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." It's an attitude, beloved, that's going to affect our work environment, because being this kind of believer transforms everything around you and enhances our witness for Jesus Christ. You see, the gospel changes things, doesn't it? We know that firsthand. When the gospel is brought into an area, or whether it's a work or environment or whatever it is, it begins to change the hearts of people around us. So who are we aiming to please? We're aiming to please Jesus Christ. Our goal is to get to a place in time where we hear our Master say, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." So we live out this new life because we're a new creation in Christ. We're showing love and we're showing grace and we're showing mercy to the people around us. Remember, Paul is writing to a congregation who quite possibly is made up of both slaves and masters. But we understand that in Christ, we're all created equal in God's sight. Every single one of them is a sinner, but every single one of them is saved by grace. All of them have value. And they go out into an unbelieving world that does not understand why believers act the way that they do. You see, the unbelieving world does things to gain favor and position here in this life, which, by the way, doesn't last. It's life's but a vapor. It's here today and it's gone tomorrow. And they're earning things that are here today and gone tomorrow, where they're going to fade and rust away. But we, beloved, are building for a kingdom of glory. But Paul says in verse 6 through 8, as we just read a minute ago, "Obey them not to win their favor when their eye is on you, but like slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart, and serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not men, because you know that the Lord will reward everyone for whatever good he does, whether he is slave or free." You see, when we learn to do things for Jesus, we're set free from this earthly servitude. And we find our joy, we find our pleasures in the tasks set before us. It's not to say that we do things that are contrary to God's goodness. In those cases, we appeal to higher authority. We can even refuse anything that would be deemed sinful. But when we can, we work to please our Father in heaven. And when that is the case, your work is never in vain. And since we do them for His pleasure and for His purposes, that kind of work, beloved, then has the power to bring us joy in knowing that He uses it for the good. He's pleased to see us at work. And the motive of service is what counts with God. It's not the external show. Listening to a Focus on the Family, I don't know if any of you all hear that show from time to time, but they had a lady on, it's been a week or so ago, and I was listening through, and this young lady had served in a teen pregnancy crisis center for several years, and she had worked there, and she had a young woman come up. They were advertising this out somewhere, and this young girl came up to her. She was obviously pregnant. She said, "Look, I'm an atheist. I am not going to believe in your Jesus, but I just want to know, can I reap some of the benefits of this program?" And she said, "Absolutely. We would love to have you come and be part of the program, and we'll take care of you. We're not going to force anything on you. You don't have to worry about that." And she said, "Great." She said, "But I don't have a ride."
She said, well, I'll tell you what you do. You give me your address, and I will pick you up every single day, and I will take you to the meetings, because I'm going to be there at work anyway, and then I'll take you home and make sure you've got lunch and all that sort of thing, and that's fine. And so for the whole time that this young girl was pregnant, she would go and pick her up and take her to the meetings, make sure everything was taken care of. When the baby was born, they made sure she had diapers and wipes and blankets and all that sort of thing that goes with this. And then she never heard from that girl again. Until about a couple years later, she got a phone call. And this young girl called her. She said, Miss So-and-so, she said, you'll never believe what happened to me. She said, I have been in some really tough times. She said, I didn't believe in God at first, like you was telling me all these Bible verses and preaching to me and sharing these things with me. And she said, but the other day I was sitting in this restaurant and I kind of came to my end. And I said, God, if you are real and you are with me, would you tell me? And out of the blue, this young man that works there walked up to me and she said, ma'am, I've never did anything like this before. And I am so nervous about this. But I just feel like I need to tell you that Jesus loves you. And he turned around and he walked away. And she said, in that moment, I knew that God was real. And he wanted me to follow him. And I don't know what to do now. So this lady that had ministered to her years before got on the phone. She called a pastor of a local church that was close by and had this young girl come and meet with him. And he talked her through it. And she accepted Jesus Christ and got plugged into that church. And now they're helping take care of it. You see, here's the example of two people that were being faithful in the positions that God had put them in. One lady that was working in a pregnancy crisis center and another guy that was just at a restaurant and happened to walk up to this young lady and said, Jesus loves you. In our passage, the labor itself becomes the ministry of sorts and it's made useful by Jesus for the conversion of sinners and the edification of the saints. You see, that's the joy and the crown that we receive in this future blessing. But it's no small blessing that we have. Labor in any kind of good work is usefulness to the Lord. It's profitable for both men, and it does not merit our eternal life. The good work of godly people follows us. In Matthew chapter 6, Jesus clearly teaches that whatever we do should be done for the glory of God. We should not do it to be seen and praised by men, but we do it so that he who sees the secret of our heart is pleased and will reward us on the appointed day. Paul said in 1 Timothy, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. I am glad that whatever we commit to Jesus Christ, he is very capable and able to protect and keep for us. See, our service to God, whatever our position, he does his work in the details. His reward is greater than anything that we could ever receive here in this lifetime. His reward, beloved, is his love that covers all sin and mercy and grace. And it came out of Calvary. Because at Calvary, God was at his best, delivering heaven's best for earth's worst. And it's only the shed blood of Jesus Christ and this grace that is bestowed upon sinners like you and I. You see, it was there that Jesus served out of a heart in order that we might have salvation. Remember, he humbled himself in that passage that we read in Philippians and became obedient even to death upon a cross. Therefore, if we claim to be followers of the Lord Jesus, we need to serve out of our heart of love. In many cases, we are the only Bible that some folks will ever read. You're the witness that the world watches as they judge the Jesus that you serve. And even he said that whatever you do for the least of these, you do it in my name. I'm going to bless it. In the same respect, our passage tells us that those in positions of authority are to show respect to their brothers and sisters under them, regardless if they are believers or not.
Same idea was presented earlier to fathers not exasperating their children and to the workers to respect those very masters. Jesus even gives us a parable in Matthew chapter 18 where there's this servant in a position of power. And he owes a great debt to the king. And the king calls on the debt. And he brings the servant before him. And the servant comes and he's pleading and he's giving his case before the king. And the king says, okay, I'm going to forgive your debt. We're good. And what does that servant do, beloved? You've read the passage. He goes out and he finds a servant of his who owes him very little. And he grabs the man and begins to choke the man. And he says, you're going to pay me what you owe me right now. Then upon hearing what this servant has done, the king calls him back in. He says, now you're going to pay off all of your debt. You should have forgiven that young man. And he throws him into prison. If he had responded with the same grace and mercy given to him, all would have been well. Beloved, our Lord loves us with an everlasting love. And he has poured out his grace and mercy upon us and provided all that we need to do his will and bring joy and blessing upon us. We're called to trust him. We're called to follow his call. And our call, beloved, is to allow him to define our life and live it in such a way that men praise him. Now that's a challenge that we have. We've sang about it, living for Jesus. That's what we're called to do. But he gives us everything we need to go about doing that. Amen? That's Miss Judith, if she'll come and lead us in a song.
Join with me, living for Jesus.